Okay, I will now call to order the Town of Elon Town Council meeting for October 10th, 2023. If all who are able will please rise for the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Moving on to our consent agenda, if the town clerk will please read the items listed within the consent agenda.
Items on tonight's consent agenda. 5 minutes from our last meeting, September 25th, 2023.
Comments, questions from the council? Do you have a motion to approve by reference the items listed on the consent agenda?
I'll make that motion, Mayor.
Second?
I'll second it.
All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Moving on to public comments. Can I have the list, Lori?
Report of progress.
So this is an opportunity for residents, visitors alike to share their concerns or wishes for the town on items not listed on the agenda today. Does anyone have any general public comments? Any online?
Nobody is indicating if they have anything to add.
All right. We will close the public comment section. Moving on to proclamations, if you wish to read the proclamations for the month of October, they include October as Fire Prevention Month, Breast Cancer Awareness Month, Community Planning Month, and National Domestic Violence Awareness Month. Those are all going to be posted on our website if you wish to read those. Moving on to public hearings, we'll start with letter A, which is right-of-way abandonment of Gregory Drive.
Hey, good evening, Madam Mayor, members of the board. I would like to state that all state statutes have been met for this public hearing. At this time, I would like to submit my staff report into the record. And the first case you have this evening is the Gregory Drive right-of-way abandonment. So just to give you a little bit of background information, on July 21st of this year, James Beasley and Michael and Janice Bird submitted an application for right-of-way abandonment for Gregory Drive. And Gregory Drive was depicted in Exhibit A, an attachment that was included in your packet. It contains approximately 26,116 square feet. And you also have an Exhibit B, which is described by meets and bounds. The next slide is just kind of an aerial for those of you not familiar with Gregory Drive. Let's see, just a little. So Gregory Drive is right here, and you've got Orange Drive right here, and then you have Earl kind of teeing right into it, Earl Drive. On the north side of Gregory Drive, a little delay in this, is Mr. Beasley's property, this parcel and this parcel. This one does have frontage on, that's Weitzel. And then down below are Mr. and Mrs. Bird's two properties. This aerial has changed. If you've been out to the site, there has been some clearing on the south side of the property as the Birds are preparing to build a new single family dwelling on their lot. So this is Exhibit A, which was included in your packet. And since this was originally submitted, the Birds have combined their two parcels. So those two parcels are now one parcel. that has frontage on Orange Drive, and I asked them to do this. So if this petition was approved, we didn't create the landlocked parcel in the rear. I think they also wanted to combine it just for the ease of building their new home. So this map, after speaking with the town attorney about this, he stated that the petitioners could also submit an additional map, which we asked them to label as Exhibit C, depicting how they would like for the land to be subdivided. Typically, half of the right-of-way would go to the adjoining property owner to the north, and half would go to the south. Since Mr. Beasley acquired a portion of the right-of-way many years ago, which was up in this area here, Mr. Beasley only requested that this portion, sorry, this mouse is nuts. There we go. You know what I'm trying to point out. He requested just the north side of Gregory Drive to be combined with his property. And then that left the south side to be combined with Bird's. The property that would be combined with Mr. Beasley's is approximately 8,633 square feet, and the remaining 17,434 square feet on that south side would go to Mr. and Mrs. Bird. The Technical Review Committee reviewed this application at their August 9th meeting, and they recommended approval of the petition. So North Carolina General Statutes gives this town council certain authority when considering a right-of-way abandonment within the limits. And basically we're looking at that it's not detrimental to the public interest or property rights of individuals, does not deprive any owners nearby of reasonable use of their property. And that should actually say is not contrary to an adopted policy to preserve existing right-of-way connectivity. So pursuant to the general statutes, notice of the intent to close this road was advertised for four consecutive weeks in the local newspaper. Copies of the resolution of intent to close and abandon the road were mailed to the three adjacent property owners by certified mail, and two signs were posted on the property, which we received an enormous amount of phone calls, but folks seemed okay once they realized what the request was. Staff finds that the right-of-way abandonment is not detrimental to the public interest, does not deprive any individuals of a reasonable means of ingress or egress to the property, and does not adversely affect connectivity in the area. Therefore, we recommend approval of the right-of-way abandonment petition for Gregory Drive, along with the accompanying adoption resolution to close and abandon Gregory Drive. That resolution is an item listed later on your agenda. I just wanted to mention it now because it's kind of two parts, considering the petition and then considering the amount. And if you have any questions for me at this time, I'll be happy to answer them.
Questions for the board before we open the public hearing? We will now open the public hearing. If anyone wishes to speak on this item, please stand, state your name and your address. Anything online?
Nobody is indicating online that they have a comment.
All right, hearing none, we will close the public hearing. At this point, I believe the request is to make a vote to approve the right-of-way abandonment petition.
That is correct.
Do I have a motion to approve the right-of-way abandonment petition?
I'll make that motion. Resolution to abandon Gregory Drive.
Thank you. A second?
I'll second it.
All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? And we will vote on that resolution, that portion as well. All right, moving on to our second public hearing of the evening, related to conditional rezoning CRZ 2023-01 Manning Avenue LLC.
Mayor, members of the council, the next item is the Manning Avenue LLC conditional rezoning. Again, all state statutes and LDO requirements have been met for this public hearing, and I'd like to submit my staff report into the record at this time. The request that you have before you tonight is for a parcel 110220, located on Manning Avenue. And they are requesting a conditional rezoning from NR to NRCPD. Please note that stream protection overlay will remain in place. So the parcel is currently vacant. It previously contained woodlands as depicted on the aerial photograph. However, a majority of those trees have since been removed. To the west of the property, you have single family dwellings in the Manning Way subdivision. To the south, you have single family dwellings. To the east, you have a single family dwelling and woodlands. And to the north, you have a vacant parcel that is part of the Powerline Church of Nazarene site. So I tried to kind of blow up the next two slides just so you can see the site plan a little bit better. So the parcel originally had two stream buffers on it. One was actually on this north side up here, and one was down here on the south side. The property was cleared earlier this year, and the stream buffer along the northern property boundary was inadvertently cleared. So the town planning staff, along with the engineer and representatives from the North Carolina Department of Environmental Quality, met the property owner and his engineer on site to discuss manners in which the property could be brought into compliance. So the stream on the northern portion of the property is now proposed to be piped underground to the rear of the property, where it kind of lets out, and you can kind of see better on the next slide, but that is in compliance with the state and with our town engineer. Since that stream buffer is now being piped, or that stream rather, the stream buffer is going away for a large portion of that northern area of the property, but it is remaining along that southeast corner. So another kind of zoomed in graphic, because I feel like you got a lot going on there. And you can also kind of see that pipe that I just talked about on the, come on, mouse, up on the northern portion of the, what's up there somewhere? Anyway, the black line across the line. The black line across the top of the screen is the pipe, the proposed pipe to take the stream underground. So again, as I stated, the property is currently zoned NR, and the use of a duplex is a use that is allowed by right in the NR zoning district. The property owner is not able to meet three of the standards that's contained in our current LDO, and is subsequently requesting a conditional rezoning along with three very specific waivers, which were included in your packet. They include a waiver for parking on the front of the residence. The applicant has stated that the driveways and the subsequent parking are needed in front of the residences due to the site constraints, as we talked about, the stream buffers and the stream that's being piped. They're also requesting a waiver for the driveway width in excess of 24 feet. They stated that there are pairs of 18 feet wide driveways that total in excess of 36 feet, which is wider than the 24 allowed by code. And the driveways are arranged in order to minimize the environmental impacts to the buffers. I will say that the driveway locations also came about during TRC review, during our conversations with NCDOT and USPS, so far as kind of bringing those driveways together to reduce the curb cuts and make it easier for the mail carrier. The last waiver is a lot area in excess of 10,200 square feet. The applicant has stated that only two lots can be created from this tract with the significant buffer overlays that affects the actual usable area of the lots. So the property owner is proposing, as you can see on the screen, to create two lots. There's a line going right kind of down the middle of it. One lot is 17,200 square feet. The other one is 25,220 square feet, and the maximum lot size normally allowed in NR is 10,000 square feet, and that's why he's requesting the waiver. As you can see on the map, there's one duplex shown on each lot. Both duplexes are 3,355 square feet, and each unit will have three bedrooms. So the applicant has submitted four-sided elevations for the two proposed duplexes. This is not a requirement of the LDO, but however, he wanted to include them with his submittal. And I believe he said that they would be white vinyl siding with vertical siding on the front. And I believe horizontal on the three other sides, black architectural shingles. And if you have more questions about the elevations after my presentation, the applicant and his engineer is here as well. So compatibility with the comprehensive plan, the Envision Elon 2040 plan identifies the site as a mixture of low density residential, conservation, and commercial. Staff feels that it meets the future land use plans, albeit in slightly different locations on the parcel, and that it also meets one of the goals outlined in the comprehensive plan, and that is to expand housing choices in the town. And there is the comprehensive map, or plan map. You can kind of see that it calls for a small portion of commercial, conservation, and then the residential. The Technical Review Committee reviewed the application at their July 12th and July 26th meetings and recommended approval of the project. On August the 22nd, the property owner and his team held a neighborhood meeting here at the town hall. Only one person attended, and there were no concerns expressed by that individual about the proposed project. Based on the information contained in the staff report, staff recommends approval of the requested conditional district rezoning to NRCPD to include the three additional waivers for parking, driveway width, and for lot area. And at the planning board meeting on September 19th, the planning board voted unanimously 6-0 to recommend approval of the conditional rezoning as well. And that is all I have this evening for you. If you have any additional questions, I'll be happy to answer them. As I previously stated, the property owner and his engineer is here as well.
I know we have at least one person here for the public hearing, but let's just go ahead and have questions from the council.
I just have one quick question, and that is, based on what we're seeing with the design, a car will have to back out onto Manning in order to come in and come out. Is that correct? A little concerned about that. Okay.
I guess I'll piggyback off that. The driveway is 18 foot, and there's going to be four of them, but kind of together. So we're assuming three people are going to live in each duplex. What is the setback of the driveway from the road? Are they going to,
of the driveway? How about that?
Yeah.
I don't remember the exact length. The engineer might know the exact distance of the driveway. I know, as I stated previously, they were asked to be kind of grouped together for DOT and for USPS. I know that they provide the minimum amount of parking spaces required. I don't know that exact length number without even squinting on my plan. Chad might be able to answer that question.
So, Chad Huffine, 505 East Davis Street. I'm the civil engineer for Mr. Haybar. There is 20 feet between the right-of-way and the front face of the building. There's room for two cars in each of those 18-foot wide driveways. They're paired together where they join the Manning Avenue pavement to create a single curb cut that's about 36 to 42 feet wide. In the planning board meeting, the same discussion about parking and having three spaces versus a visitor space, all of that came up during the discussion. We talked about putting a space in the area where the two trees are, kind of near the center property line. That is not required by the NR section of the ordinance. The parking requirements for the ordinance are met. However, that was brought up in planning board, and you should be aware that questions are consistent. And I can answer things more.
Parking requirement isn't met.
It may be.
It's not, because it has to be around the back.
The number of parking spaces.
Okay.
Requirement is met. The waiver is requested because we cannot park the cars behind the homes as the ordinance currently required. That language is going away with the adoption of your new land development ordinance, but at this time, at the time of the submittal, we have to ask for that section to be waived because we simply can't get in the stream book.
So how do we envision four cores in a single driveway?
We would have to widen those driveways.
So as is, it's not going to work. So three people are living there. There's three cores.
Yeah, you're going to have two cores.
Comes over.
That's correct.
But they're only going to be able to have two cores?
That's correct.
So
where's the third one go? There's going to be a third one.
There's going to be a third bedroom.
If I could. No, for you, Chad. Each unit is going to have two parking spaces?
Yes.
So not two for the duplex, but two for unit one, two for unit two.
That's correct.
Okay. So each unit will have the two parking spaces according to code.
I guess my concern is, you know, I think what we've been trying to work towards is some conformity where parking is in the rear. And I think, as you pointed out, one of the concerns I had was proximity of the, I mean, obviously there's land there. Now, why you chose, you said 20 feet from the right of way, which would give you a driveway length of what?
So that's minimum. It meets the ordinance, and that's it. The driveway is going to appear to be about 32 feet
long. But we still have to back out into that road.
Correct. We're required to store the car on the private property outside the right of way. So we provide that length, the typical parking space that Elon requires, length and width, outside the right of way. The driveway appears to be longer, but we're not parking cars in that area.
So what would happen if you set those two duplexes back? Right?
I'm sorry.
If you set the two duplexes further back,
stream buffer. So then we run into the conflicts with the stream buffer. We're not allowed to encroach into the buffers. So the buildings are pushed just away from the buffer to facilitate grading and to allow construction. There's simply no room to build that.
And the stream buffers are defined by FEMA?
No, that's a state requirement.
State requirement.
I also want to add that that district has a minimum and a maximum that the building has to be set at. I believe Chad's right at the maximum, if not near the maximum. He can't push the building further back with not without not meeting the LDO. He'd have to request another waiver to push the buildings back. That makes sense. We want the buildings toward the road under the current LDO.
I think that something else that we need to address is this isn't the first time that I've heard in the LMO it's going to blah, blah, blah. That LMO is not approved. And I think that this conversation might drive some of that. Because I agree that it's concerning to me that these are going to be backing up. If they're rentals, there are going to be three out of town individuals, each with a vehicle parked out front. So now there's 12 vehicles that have to fit in there. They'll figure it out by parking in the yard, or they'll get in the way of traffic like they do everywhere else in town. And that's problematic.
Has our police department looked at the dangers in backing up? In that particular,
does anybody else back out on that street?
They were at both of the TRC meetings where we discussed the parking, the backing out, and the location of the parking. Nothing was expressed at the TRC.
This is out of ways, right? This is not.
It's across from that neighborhood. If you go out in the neighborhoods on the left,
that's what I thought. Yeah. So they're kind of standalone. There's nothing on the other side of the street. Other than maybe a part of a subdivision or something.
There's a road right there.
So I guess I have a...
Yeah, there's the road on the aerial. I see at the top of the property.
And so one of their driveways is going to be right by that T intersection? It's really hard to see on the...
Yeah, it's kind of hard.
Yeah, it looks pretty close.
Just from it or kind of...
Go back.
Yeah, if
go back. It's
going to become right at that intersection that they're going to have to pull out of. And that's what concerned me is that there are a lot of homes that live there pulling in and out, and they're trying to look left and right and not across.
So suppose that stream didn't get inadvertently cleared. If it was asked to be cleared, what would the answer have been? and how would that have been handled?
Pat probably knows that question better because he works with our engineer more.
So in the course of the development, we would ask and had asked that section be evaluated by wetland science. Wetland science initially classified it as a wetland, which was not subject to the stream buffer. However, multiple professionals looked at that classification. The state looked at that classification, as did myself and Josh. And there is slope to that channel. Well, if there is slope to the channel, then it classifies as a stream because it flows. So during that time, the wetland scientists, the state came to an agreement that this would be a buffered section of stream. That's a 50-foot buffer. We're allowed to pipe up to 150 linear feet, giving all the improvements, not just the pipe length, but any of the riprap that comes after it. So that would be typical. Apply for that. We show that on the drawing. That's accepted by the town engineer. It's also accepted by the state if required. And the buffer on that section of stream then goes away, so that you can build up to the pipe. If you needed to put a parking lot or a driveway or let the house come closer to that, you could do that. If we were allowed to do a longer piping or in a different location, put pipe in the other stream, we would have certainly done that. That forces us into a condition of mitigation where you're paying for the buffer that you're removing in addition to what you're typically allowed for each individual project. To do that makes the project unaffordable. You can't pay the mitigation and expect to develop the project successfully. We chose that stream section because it's the widest part of the lot. We're required to keep the homes a certain distance from the right-of-way, but not too close to the right-of-way by ordinance. So as the V-shape of the lot, that was the most beneficial. If the clearing had not been done, it would still be done. It's less than an acre. It would not have been permitted through the state. And it was an honest mistake by the grading contractor and the wetland scientist, which we resolved all of that as quickly as possible with the town and state and our team as well. So the long answer you just got, the short answer is it would have happened anyway.
So you mentioned it, Lori, on the staff report, but also I guess the goal and the Envision Elon 2040 to expand housing choices. So I agree, you know, this expands housing choices. Then it continues to say it appeals to a diverse range of preferences and income levels, encourage product mix of multi-generational and age-in-place neighborhoods. So with that in there, I guess this goes to the developer of, what are you envisioning? Because what I'm envisioning is this is going to be student housing, that we're going to have students there. And if we're only going to have two spots and it's student housing, I know there's going to be 3+ cars per unit. And so I just want to see how this appeals to a diverse range of preferences and income levels.
Well, guys, I'm Anthony Hazar. I own a couple of the houses in Manning Way subdivision that you guys were referring to. All of those, I don't rent those out to students. Those are to either, I have a single guy, I have a young family. So saying that they're going to have 3 cars, I can't assume that. So if I need more space, you got to tell me if I need more space, but I don't know who they're going to rent out to yet. I know that I have 3 bedrooms, they're all upstairs. So it's not going to be the older population with the bedrooms being upstairs. So I know with the younger families, with the other rentals that I have in that area, they're younger families, so I can't dictate on how many cars they're gonna have at the time. I know that's a very vague answer. I'm sorry.
What's the price point going to be on these versus the homes that you have in that area?
They'll be about $2,000 a month.
And what do the homes run for?
Mine said $1,950, $1,850, $1,875. Yes, ma'am.
I think your point, Wynn, is that my concern is, as we know, people will come visit these people. In Manning Way, in your neighborhood, when you rent properties, you have a street where people can park out on the street. You can't park out on Manning Avenue. And I guess that's the concern that I have, is that, is that going to be responsibility, not your responsibility, if it's going to be a responsibility for the police department maintain, make sure that folks aren't legally parking out in the road. I guess that's my concern, is that without having parking around the rear where you could, normally that's what duplexes would have, additional parking spaces for when someone came over or someone does get a third vehicle, which typically happens. So I don't.
So Lori, can you, I know it was before your time. I don't know if we can answer it. But in our current LMO, we do have it where you have to park in the back. Do you know why that decision was made or how that came about?
I do not. The only thing that permits parking in the front yard is a single family dwelling. So everything else, multifamily, duplexes, has parking in the rear. I can just say in my previous planning jurisdiction and working in two other small suburban towns and working in two counties, I have not come across the parking requirement of being in the rear for a duplex. And I don't know the history of it here. I know that was in there when it was drafted, but when I look back through old copies, I believe in 2004.
So even though they can't build on the back, that's still going to be a yard in the back. And what precludes them, and I'm not saying I'm crazy about it, but what precludes them from covering the whole front with driveway? In other words, that there would be more space available for parking.
I'll let you answer it. I mean, also, I think DOT would have a say in that so far as issuing the driveway permit, but I think Chad wants to elaborate.
So I will try to answer your question. There's nothing that would. This is a conditional zone. You certainly have the opportunity to provide additional conditions, and we have the opportunity to receive those and try to accommodate them as best possible. There is no room except between the two units and to the north of Unit A. So if we were to build additional parking spaces, we would put them between Units B and C and to the north of Unit A. What your trade-off is a wide mass of concrete and change in the number of street trees and yard space. It is certainly physically, there is room there to put another 10 by 20 space between the two buildings and to the north of Unit A. When we do that, we create other conditions that we need to seek additional waivers or changes to the ordinance for. Our position in bringing this to you was, we meet the ordinance. This is a conditional zone. You have the opportunity to bring those concerns to us. We will try to receive those and make those happen. There is physical room to put additional spaces there. We can certainly consider that and bring that back to you. It will not be three spaces per unit, and we will always have the same potential to back into the public right-of-way until the ordinance in Elon prohibits that. That's something that is out of our purview and yours. I will add that the police chief and assistant chief sit in on the TRC meeting. We've discussed this at the same level of concern that you all have. We are not in a position to ordinance that's prohibit that based on the ordinance. So the things that we can work on are the number of spaces, where they're located, and that's a good place to have a dialogue tonight. To drive between the buildings and try to park in the buffer area is not doable without mitigation. To do that creates a project that may not necessarily be. So that's where we are.
Is there any discussion about people parking in the adjacent neighborhoods and then running across the street?
I myself have done that every single time I've been to the project, as has every staff member and every owner, except when we bring the big machinery. So that's going to happen. It's going to be parking on Manning Way. And if there is any opportunity to add any parking area to that, to our side of the street, we'll be glad to listen to that.
I think my biggest concern, and Chad, you've been a part of these discussions, and Anthony, hi, I know your sister, If my biggest concern is that in every conditional rezoning that we have had to date, what we have been able to guarantee to our residents is that what we are approving is a better product. So we're getting products, brick, already planked, not vinyl, right? Like that's a condition that we've been able to secure through conditional zoning. And we've been able to secure a lot of, in my opinion, really great things for other residents by giving, you know, the conditional rezoning. So in my opinion, we would be setting a precedent against what we've shared unless we make some changes. And at the end of the day, I don't have a vote, but this is my opinion. I think that we need to get something to give something through this. I think that it should be a higher quality product if we are going to consider three waivers. I'm really concerned about the parking. Chad's been here. This is a concerning thing for us because of some of the neighborhood issues that we have had in other neighborhoods around parking. Where do people park? And then, you know, a possible condition is that it not allow student rentals. You know, students are not a protected class. So you can say students cannot rent. You can check with your attorney on that, but they are not a protected class. So you can say no student housing, and maybe that solves for part of the problem, right? Because just drive down Williamson on the right, you're going to see where there's three bedrooms. There's always five cars there. And it's a constant issue for our ordinances because they're blocked in the yard, constant parties. And at the same time, we don't want it to be like a parking lot in the front. So I think that, in my opinion, if you can just look at it and see if there are things that can be done to mitigate some of the concerns that the council has, I think that that would be worthwhile. And I know that you're saying that it may not be feasible in terms of finances or whatever, but again, in my opinion, we're not getting anything by approving a conditional rezoning in this case other than a tax value, right? That's my biggest concern, is that I don't want to set a precedent that we're not getting a higher quality product with conditional rezoning, because that is what we have pushed all along in this process, that we approved Park Northwest and we said, because it's a better quality product, we're getting something better than what the zoning allows. Park East, we're approving a better quality product. We're getting more, you know, better than what we could have gone with the current zoning. And like, I get it. If you find a way to put those parking spots in the back, you can build exactly what you're proposing, just with the parking in the back. But I am concerned about the issues that the council has brought forward. Any other questions from the council? Because I know we need to open up a public hearing.
I just have one quick one. The other, Mr. Hurd, pronouncing it. Hazar. I apologize. The other three homes that you mentioned that you own,
yes, ma'am.
Are those rented out to students or are those rented out to single family?
Oh, they're single family.
Those are single families. Okay. Thank you very much. Yeah. I apologize for Mr.
And I don't want to report too much on this, but as far as it appears that I already know the answer, but turning around in there to be able to come out forwards instead of backwards, is that a way to work that out, even possible? I mean, based on what I'm seeing, it doesn't sound that way, but that's my biggest concern is the backing out, to be honest with you. But is there a way?
I'll try to answer that. So I don't necessarily see a way to do, without asking you for different waivers, without pulling the request and coming back to you next month, I don't see a way to address backing out into the street. where it's not prohibited by the ordinance, where I don't necessarily have room to accommodate a turnaround, it would require us to bring some more waiver requests to you, which would then allow us to give you a better product, to the mayor's point, which we sounds like we certainly need to be receptive to at this point. Later we listen to the concerns of the public and discuss this after the public hearing. Folks have had a chance to speak. But I do think we could certainly go back to the drawing board, try to accommodate some of these concerns. We can work with Lori and Jenna specifically on the opportunity costs of one waiver versus another. But it sounds like this parking is significantly important in the minds of everyone in the room. Maybe some of the other ones can take a second position to that one, and we can look at it again with you. So I'll sit and listen.
Well, I think my general concern is with it all, too. I know it's concerned, and like Mayor Sharp said, if they put parking in the back, you can have these duplexes. But we are about to just drop, or they are about to put duplexes all around single family homes in a neighborhood. So I echo what you said. If we're going to do that, right, it's going to look a little different. I would enjoy that higher quality of it. And my thinking for the parking in the back that was made when the LMO was drafted, so it doesn't look like an apartment complex and looks like a parking lot. So that's why when it was written, it was put in the back, because we're about to go down Manning and see a parking lot in a single family residential neighborhood. And I still just a question. I get the housing choice, but the diverse income levels and product mix for generational youth or multi-generational doesn't sound like that's the case, right? All upstairs and more expensive than a single family house. Those would be mine.
And this is a random question. Is there potential, and it's probably you gotta like look at a different zoning, I don't know, but I'm just wondering, like, is there potential for that to be for townhomes with the parking in the back if you squeeze them together?
He brought that up. It would require a rezoning of UR. There's no UR in that area because that's the only district that allows it. So then you question, is that a spot zoning, being that it's a little bit less than an acre, whereas in NR right now, single family duplexes are allowed. So that's because we had this conversation at length because that was his first intended product.
But
it's not saying it's not possible. It would require the rezoning.
Well, I'm not saying that, you know, that would be approved by the council. I'm just asking the question, could that be something that could be part of conditional rezoning? Or no, because it's still NBR, CR.
Yeah, the fact that it's a different use that's not allowed, I think I would feel more comfortable with rezoning to UR CPD. You know, it's one thing to request a waiver on setbacks. I'm trying to wear my planning hat. I don't think you can request a waiver on land use.
So I'll agree with Lori on the land use piece. And I will say that if we look back in some of the previous hearings we've been through together, the setback between the two units, B and C, is a place we could look for dimensional additions to accommodate parking. We have some places where we have units that are, you know, 5 feet off the line as opposed to 8. We could look at if we're looking at material types or a different type of exterior, then we're also looking at the ability to put those homes closer together. If we're able to put those homes closer together, still respect the lot line and the two individual lots, still have the duplex use, we create distance on the perimeter of the project, which then gives us some room to accommodate more parking. At the end of this exercise, we're not going to be able to pull into the project, turn around, and pull back out onto Manning Avenue. We'll be able to accommodate more parking, but we're just going to have a trade-off here. Right now, it's a swamp, and so we're taking a piece of property that has the potential to do a lot more than it's doing right.
Anybody else before we open public hearing? All right. We will now open the public hearing on this item. I believe Mr. Eldridge, you wanted to speak?
You
want to come on up and introduce yourself and your address, please.
I'm John Elder. I own a single family home on 673 North Manning, which touches them. I want to pull back a little bit and get to basics. When the LLC bought this property, it was zoned. Two single family units. Now he wants to do two duplexes, four units. Well, he's just cut his land cost in half. This is nothing but greed, simple greed. If you stand there on that lot and you turn all the way around, what do you see? Nothing but single family homes. And he wants to put two story duplexes. I'm going to set on that. But if you stand up and turn around and see all these single family homes that people purchase with hard-earned money, and when they bought them, they went to the town of Elon and said, what's the zoning in that area? What can they build? And town of Elon said, single family homes. And that's what was built there. The people who bought those homes felt protected. And that's a trust. They trust you. They feel trustworthy to put their money into all these single family homes. 360 degrees, as far as you see, single family homes, not two-story duplexes that sit right on the road. And if you'll go to that lot, there's water on the right, there's water on the left, and a sewer easement going up the middle. And one more thing, if you'll go out to that property, the catch basin for the University Boulevard development, guess where it is? Right behind this property. And all that water's going to come, hit that catch basin, and they think they can pipe it out. I think it's just greed or it's trust. It's very simple to me. And if you've got any other questions for me, please go out to the lot and look at it. It's a dog lot surrounded by water with more water coming from that new development. And to put two duplexes and a thing, and he, when he bought it, they were single family homes. He knew it. And to go from two to four, that's just greed. Thank you.
Any other public comments? Just to clarify something, by right, Mr. Hazar is able to put a duplex there, but the parking would just have to be in the back and these other two items would have to be met?
Yes.
In any single family lot?
Yes, in our
area.
Current zoning, yes. If he came in and met all the code requirements and didn't need those waivers, we would absolutely issue a zoning permit and the planning board, the town council, no one would ever see it until construction began on site.
And how long has that been the case?
Since 2004, to my knowledge.
At least since 2004.
Yes. It's proposed tentatively to change in the LMO, proposed tentative, to look at having duplexes as a special use permit in the NR. It's how the current draft them going forward.
So it wouldn't be allowed by right with the currently proposed language.
Mm-hmm. Currently it's allowed
by the, in the current proposed. In the limo.
And special use permit required the public hearing process.
Thank you. Any other public comments? Any online?
I have not seen anybody online.
We will close the public hearing.
Before we close it, I was just going to suggest, I don't know, thank you, if you want the applicant to make any changes, if you want to receive any new applicant information that we would need to continue the public hearing to a meeting at a later date, if you were to submit something new to you. So I was just going to suggest that option. Depending on how the board felt about the project, if you wanted to perhaps continue it to a date specific, I don't know if Chad knows that date, but either your next meeting or the following meeting, because it sounds like there might be some potential changes, and I don't know if the board wanted to consider that or not. Of course, you have the option to close the public hearing.
So keep the public hearing open.
I think if you would like to see a revised plan, I would recommend it, that you continue it to a date specific.
Okay. That's fine. Anyone opposed to leaving the public hearing?
No, I would like to see a solution that we all can find acceptable. And I think if we were to vote no, that closes the door. It creates another problem. You have to wait a year to bring this back, right? If we keep the public period open, it gives him an opportunity to work with you and staff, come back with a solution if they want to present again.
It does, absolutely. The only thing I would say to Chad is packets typically go out a week in advance. So I don't know if this is something you could address in the next week or if you wanted to wait till the November meeting.
If I may, Madam Mayor, I think it's time for me to speak. While the public has spoken and given some additional concerns, I think we would like to ask that you continue the public hearing for at least one meeting cycle to give us an opportunity to take these concerns that not only the mayor, not only the group of you all here, but also the citizens have. Let us look at the drawings, see what we can do to provide additional items so that as you see it, hopefully, if you grant the continuance, next meeting will bring you a maybe a little better horizontally accommodating. And
Chad, the next upcoming meetings are October 23rd.
I was just going to say that. It's a short timeline, just so you know.
What's the one following?
November 14th.
Okay. It's entirely up to you when you, if you grant a continuance of this hearing, when you allow us to come back, I would ask for the November meeting if that's suitable to you.
I don't know why we'd be opposed to put it to November 14th.
Totally fine with that.
I want you to have a fair opportunity. And,
yeah. It's too rushed.
I don't want anybody to do it. So I'll give plenty of time.
All right. Well, we will continue the public hearing to November 14th.
Thank you very much.
To a motion.
Motion, Mayor, then we continue.
I'll second
to that. November 14th meeting.
All in favor?
Aye.
Motion carries.
Is that a 6 o'clock?
Thank you.
Yes. 6 o'clock. Yes.
All right.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. All right, moving on to old business, review and consider recommendation from the DEB committee regarding town code amendment rules of construction.
Okay. I can give the brief introduction. Representatives from the Diversity, Equity, and Belonging Committee were your meeting back in June.
When we made the proposal?
Yeah. Is that in June?
Yes.
Okay. So you're here in June and suggested a change to the rules of construction in our town code, which currently talks about, you know, where it says man, it means person, corporation, business. The recommendation at the time was to change that to refer to any gender. The council at the time said, well, rather than doing all these changes incrementally or one at a time, bring back changes in bulk, and we can do them 3 or 4 times rather than a dozen times. They've come back because the only change that they are recommending is this change to the rules of construction. In their reading through the code, they haven't seen anything that says this is discriminatory language or disenfranchising language or anything like that, other than this one item. So they wanted to come back, present it back to you, and go from there. So with that, I can turn it over to the folks from the DEP committee and let them speak.
Good evening. I feel like I want to say may it please the court, but I know that. I've got a few documents I want to read. One is the resolution, which you're all familiar with. The other is just a summary of what our committee has been doing in response to the resolution that was passed by the town council in August of 2021. And of course,
is this different than what we have already at our table?
I think it's the same.
It is
the same document. So I don't think I'm not going to pass this one over.
Timeline for Town of Elon Diversity Initiatives.
Okay. All right. Yeah. You have.
We gave him a copy of that.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. Great. Great. Okay. All right. So, as you know, the resolution was passed in on August 10th, 2021, and it encouraged the creation of our committee with three charges: to evaluate municipal policies and ordinances for discriminatory impacts, to create a forum for public input, and to make recommendations to the then Board of Aldermen for any future actions related to any discrimination within the community. And so what you already have in front of you is a timeline for the activities of the committee. So I thought it would be important for you all to know what we've been doing since the resolution and since the establishment of the committee. And let me say, tonight we have with us our chair, Rose Cooper, and two of our members, Jan Pagoria and Michael Woods. We also have two other members. Councilwoman Borland is a member representing the board, and Mahmoud Ajazi, who is been very active and is now moving to New Jersey. And so that constitutes our committee, and we've been supported by both the town manager and the town clerk. So we started meeting in April, after the original three committee members were appointed on November 8th, 2022. Between April 2023 and this month, we've held seven public meetings here in the town hall. We set our regular meeting as the first Monday of the month, and those dates are listed in the town newsletter and online. We have other people who've expressed interest in joining, so it's good that we are being made known to the public. After a review of the town ordinance, which is one of the first things we were asked to do, we reached the following conclusions. One, that the ordinances are non-discriminatory or neutral on their face. So when you look at the ordinances, you don't see any glaring evidence of discrimination. The committee will continue to determine what data is needed and how best to determine if the application of any ordinances are having a discriminatory impact. And remember, in the ordinance, we were asked to evaluate the policies and ordinances for discriminatory impact. So we've done some preliminary work in that area. Rich has helped Jan. They've started looking at water bills and to see if there's any evidence that second notices or cutoffs are disproportionately impacting certain areas. And we've started looking at census data and just trying to get a big picture view of the town. And so some examples that we've talked about where we might want to look for potential discriminatory impact, who are the code enforcement officers and what is their training? Are we practicing considerations of diversity and inclusion in the work of those officers? We've got housing ordinances. We've got parking, or we've got all kinds of ordinances, but we've been asking Rich to help us figure out what data we need to see if there is any evidence of discriminatory impact. And then finally, the language in the rules of construction was what we recommended in June as an amendment, because we didn't see anything else in the ordinance that suggested a discriminatory impact. Now, as an aside, I will say that it might behoove the committee to have the town attorney, and I believe the ordinances were reviewed not too long ago, but just to have the town attorney look at those ordinances for any thoughts that he or she might have about that. But based on our review, they're neutral on their. When we looked at the rules of construction, we propose the following amendment. So the original rule is a word importing the masculine gender only shall extend to and be applied to females and to firms, partnerships, and corporations, as well as males. Our proposed amendment, which is in line with what many businesses and corporations and educational institutions have moved towards, is the following. The words person, people, they, them, shall extend to all gender identities. Now, I believe there was some discussion at the last meeting as to why this proposed amendment didn't include the original language of firms, partnerships, and corporations. So there's a potential second proposed amendment. The words person, they, them, him slash his, her slash she, shall extend to all gender identities as well as firms, partnerships, and corporations. Now, this is a rule of construction. So even if we didn't include the words firm, partnership, and corporation, it wouldn't mean that they're not covered by the ordinance, because this is just a rule of construction. It's not the ordinance itself. Okay. But there's no reason not to look at this second proposed amendment, which would bring that language back in. We've got the original proposed amendment. We've got some additional language that would be more inclusive of the original language and maybe address some of the concerns that were raised at the last meeting. I will say that this one of the second charges to the committee in the original resolution was to create a forum for public input. And we have been having conversations about that. About possibly meeting offsite so that we could invite members of the community to share whatever issues they have. That's a way of finding out anecdotally if there's some concern about disparate impact. And so we're slowly moving in that direction to meet that charge as well. But right now we feel as if we've met the first charge, which is to evaluate the code. And this is the one recommendation that we're making.
Questions?
No, I just want to make a comment. And first, my apologies to this amazing lady. They are so diligent and hardworking. And I haven't been able to be there as I'd like to, just due to some health reasons. But in speaking with the chairperson, the work that y'all have done has been amazing. The amount of time and coming tonight is just amazing. So I would really like to move forward, because I know there's a lot more work that you have that you want to progress with. So whatever we can do to start moving forward and getting more things done, because I know we have a hardworking group here, and I don't want to lose that momentum that you all have been doing. So
I have. So this proposed amendment is something that we can do as soon as possible. Is that correct?
Yes, I believe so.
Okay. Mm-hmm. So in other words, when you're talking about some public inputs, things like that, would that include areas such as law enforcement, the kinds of ways that the town operates in terms of other, like you were putting code enforcement, those kinds of mm-hmm, things, but then maybe even the fire department, mm-hmm, that kind of mm-hmm. thing. So you're talking about all levels, not just the ordinances and things like that.
When we talk about public input or engaging with the public, first of all, I think it's important for the public to know about this committee and to know that the committee is moving. But it's also a way for us to hear from members of the community. And I'll give you an example. When I was co-chair of our bias response review working group at Elon, we did our research, and then we had hearings or meetings all over the campus. We met with our new police chief. We met with people in maintenance. We met with faculty. We met with staff. We met with students. We met with every constituency in the university to get their sense of, did they know about the system? What improvements could they make? I would say that this committee would do something similar. We would certainly want to meet with the enforcement officers, meet with the fire chief, or meet with the police chief, and then go out to, we talked about meeting at some of the community centers, some of the churches, with the general public. And I think, of course, one of the goals of a committee like this, and it's consistent with language in the resolution, this is about building harmony and people feeling as if their concerns on whatever it is are being heard. And so I feel like that's part of our mission, and that's one of the reasons that we want to move outside the building, so to speak, at some point and get input. So it would serve two purposes. One, just building public confidence, but also giving us the beyond the numbers. We can get the quantitative data from Rich, and Jan has been really good about, we've got all kinds of skills on the committee, because don't show me numbers. But then we need to get that qualitative input from people in the community. So that would be our second mission once we get past getting this proposal.
The only reason I ask that is that I remember when this was being dealt with, that there was some part of the conversation about, I'm not sure what power we have with that, but with employers in the area, mm-hmm, and corporations, mm-hmm, or, mm-hmm, groups, if there was any kind of discrimination in terms of hiring practices, mm-hmm, things, mm-hmm, like that.
Mm-hmm.
I didn't know if that played a role or not. I'm not sure if, to answer that or anybody else, but.
Yeah, well, there's language in the ordinance to that,
okay,
in the resolution to that effect. That we would want to encourage employers.
Would that be involved in any of the kinds of?
Probably, yes. Like I said, we want to meet and reach as many constituencies in the community as possible, business leaders as well.
That's what I wanted to hear. Mm-hmm. Thank you.
I guess this is a question for Rich. So with the original wording, a word importing the masculine gender shall extend and apply to females, firms, partnerships, corporations. So as it reads now, it says, speaking to our police chief or our town manager, is he, would it be changed to they or them, or would it read the same, but we would just have a disclaimer at time?
We would change the definition of what we're saying. The word importing the masculine gender would mean all genders. Is in essence what we're trying to do. Or what the committee is trying to do. We're not going to go through and edit page by page by page by page by page, largely because of the cost of doing something like that. Every time we touch a page, we get charged, we're talking thousands and thousands of dollars to go and make all those kind of the edits. So I recall one of the readings, we didn't actually, and it may be a smaller issue than you think, we didn't use the gender specific terminology in any of the codes to any great extent, did we?
Well, yeah, and let me say, this is low-hanging fruit. Once you put this amendment in, then you don't have to go back and change any of the gendered language that may be in there, unless you choose to do so later on. But that's what the rule of construction does. It says, if you look at ordinance 2.5 and it says he, well, the rule of construction is telling you that this extends to all gender identities. It's not just a gendered provision, right? When I looked at the ordinances, I only saw a few examples of gendered language, like, and it would be like his/her. Most of the language was person, which is good, because then you wouldn't have a big job of going back and I would think maybe somebody did that a while back and just said, look, let's not say he, let's say he, she, or him, her. But most of it is person. So that made it easy to just say, if you see the word person, they, them, his, her, whatever you see, then it extends to all gender identities, yeah. and it's not gendered. So,
and then the second thing, I guess it's more of a comment. I don't see it in Granicus. So originally with this old business, we had maybe an email that was sent by one of the members asking, you know, kind of direction. What did we see as council members? What your committee did?
There was last week they we had included a list of questions that they were asking.
Mm-hmm.
I think it's been revised a couple of times since that packet went out. And I don't think they're asking those questions anymore.
I think it's referring to the question about what did the council see mm-hmm. as, but I think that's answered by the resolution. Yeah. I mean, that's why rather than ask that question, it's like listen to the resolution. That's the answer to the question, right? Because our marching orders, so to speak, are laid out in the resolution.
Yeah.
Now we would welcome anyone from the council to attend our meetings.
Monday at 9 a.m.?
Monday at 9 a.m., yes. We need to meet for an hour. Very rarely do we go over an hour. And of course, in between meetings, we communicate by email. We've invited a couple of people to come to our meetings just to see what they're doing in other towns, which I saw in the meeting minutes leading up to the resolution. Well, what's going on in Chapel Hill? What's going on? And so we've been doing that. We've been reaching out, trying to get the manager, the housing and equity director at the town of Davidson to come speak to us because they did something similar to what we're doing and created that position. So we thought it'd be interesting to hear from him. But it would be great if you all could come, you know, at any time. And again, we at some point want to meet offsite. We talked about meeting in the evening, not necessarily in our regular meeting day, but in between an offsite location so we could get more involvement from the community. So all that to say, we sort of feel like the questions, the answers to those questions are embedded here.
Yeah, I think that, you know, the resolution says a lot for it. I worked up some words and trying to figure out some ideas with it. So I think they're all touched here, right? Mm-hmm. So, you know, having collaboration with the Dev Committee and the town, reviewing our policies and procedures, right? So not mm-hmm. just, so I think you touched on that of mm-hmm. being with our chief of police and our chief the fire department, helping us as a town figure out how to celebrate diversity, right? So, you know, we started kind of doing that by a couple, you know, winter holidays with having the Hanukkah, representing Hanukkah mm-hmm. downtown. And also one of the other ones is like community education. And I think you hit on that. So that's what I envision Dev Committee doing is really helping and being an extension of the town and reaching in that regard. And I would love to come to some of your meetings. A 9 a.m. meeting is going to be super tough for me. So if we are meeting, if it works for the committee, that's what needs to continue to happen. But I would definitely encourage, you know, if you do community roundtables in an evening or something, you know, can't count me in on stuff like that. But a 9 a.m. Monday meeting is gonna be a tough swing. I appreciate what you guys are doing. And I think this is, you know, a quick, like you said, low hanging fruit, something we can do easily. And it does show and demonstrate to our residents and surrounding areas that, you know, we're serious of trying to.
May I say something?
Yeah. Hello.
Hey, everyone. Wendy, I just want to make a small correction. When we only meet the first Monday, so it's not every Monday.
Oh, did I say every Monday?
Well, when you meet, it gave Monday, the impression. Yeah.
Right. Okay. All right. Yeah. The first Monday of every month.
Right.
Okay.
Yeah. And has something she'd like to say.
I'm speaking as an individual, not for the committee, but I think one of the things we want to do is hear from residents about what's valuable to them. Sometimes a celebration is fun and everything, but maybe they want something a little more tangible and relevant to them to be addressed.
How do you want to celebrate?
Or not even just how do I want to celebrate? Can I tell you when I felt like I was discriminated against?
Yes.
That's, you know, we want to hear and maybe find out from them when the town does a great job. How do they want to celebrate that? Mm-hmm. And not just presume we know. And not presume that 6:30 on Thursday is for everybody.
And I think, too, you know, some of the data points, you know, that you could look at. One example is after we passed the noise ordinance, we had several students really over the course of a few years come about and say, we believe this is disproportionately affecting Black students. Well, when we pulled the data, there were zero Black students who had received that that particular ticket at that point, right? So I think that there's definitely data to be looked at, you know, depending on what you all want to do. But also thinking about, you know, I handle job accommodations, you know, for my company. Mm-hmm. And, you know, what are we doing for people with disabilities, right? Are we making sure that we're addressing them in our policies and procedures? You know, what are we, you know, I had another group that I wanted to address too, and I don't remember what it was now. Oh, I brought this up to Rich. I was at the Mayor's Association and they were talking about female firefighters. And I said to Rich, I said, what would we do? Because right now we don't have a separate locker room.
I have that answer for you, by the way.
Oh, nice. So those types of things, just like making sure that we're, you know, we're thinking about all the protected classes generally and how we can address those, mm-hmm. you know, even like playground equipment, right? You know, is that accessible to all children?
And or senior citizens.
Right. Mm-hmm. You know, so, you know, thinking about it, obviously that's even more broad, right? You know, so just thinking about what can we do? Mm-hmm. In those areas as well, that I think that this is a great first start. And I think a public forum is going to be excellent. I think that that's something worth hearing. You know, one example is when the police department hosts National Night Out, for example, they do that in the ballpark neighborhood. And they show up, the people in the neighborhood show up, and it's one of the only times that I have seen that neighborhood show up to a town event because we went to them.
Yes, exactly.
Right.
And the other thing I would just say, throw out there as an idea, it makes a lot of sense whenever there is an event, perhaps we can have a table or something and hand out a survey or a link or something like that so that nobody has to address their issues right at that moment. But yeah, I think going to take a walk down the street, all streets. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And Mayor, it's interesting you should use that noise ordinance as an example, because a lot of times the data doesn't necessarily support the reality. And I say that because when my son was a junior at Elon, he got a ticket for a noise ordinance, him and his three roommates. So you hear stories from people that don't necessarily show up in the data. In fact, we heard the story several months after it happened, of course, but just the whole scene, like the way he described it and what happened, it was just, you know, it was upsetting to me as a parent, especially, but as an African-American member of the community, it was also upset. And so a lot of times you don't see the numbers, but you hear the stories.
And do you know that if it was town police versus university police? Because that's another thing mm-hmm. that we constantly get feedback on.
Well, he was living off campus. So I think it was.
Well, so if.
They have jurisdiction.
Yeah.
It depends on where off campus.
So right. Can the campus police send people to write tickets for misdemeanors? That was probably the town police, right?
The town police don't patrol station at Mill Point. Campus police do.
This was down on Haggard, way down on Haggard.
Okay.
Campus Trace. So I think it was the town police because he had to go to court.
Yeah.
Well, the campus police have the same jurisdictions, so they have the same abilities. But
yeah. But either way, it's you know, again, people don't necessarily make the distinction, which right. is important to know as well.
Yes. Yeah.
So. I think the important thing that you're bringing up is that we won't know these things unless we're talking to people in the neighborhoods and hearing the stories.
Yes.
If you're not there, you don't know.
Yes. So we're anxious to get out of the building.
I'd like to make a comment. I appreciate the participation that you've seen 7 public meetings in the past year. I think it's really important. I think I equate this to we hire auditors to keep us physically sound, make sure we're in compliance, and make sure that we're treating citizens fairly. And a lot of these things don't happen overnight. Mm-hmm. We're still waiting for an ADA-approved entryway to our front door. This gentleman had to go through our police department.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Those are things that should have happened 2 years ago.
Yeah,
but we're slow to react and do those things. So I don't want anyone to be discouraged because what you've done is a basis for what we're looking at. The ultimate goal is that we don't need this committee anymore. I think we make this a perfect place. That should be our goal.
That's
not
a good
to continue,
goal.
Not to continue to find, try to create problems, look for problems, but let's deal with the problems that are at hand. And encouraging people to come out and be vocal. You talk about the ballpark community. I wish more people would come out. I think the last election, that she ran, I think 12 people, maybe it was 12 people voted over there. That's where we have to get people involved. This is one of the most important things. These people who sit up here have to address all these decisions that have to be made. And if you sit idle, then you're not participating in a right that you've earned to do that and vote. So I encourage people to do that.
Mm-hmm.
I do. I appreciate the work you're doing. I look forward to hearing more from you.
I'll just add one more thing because we've talked about the university did a history and memory project where they looked at the history of the university through the experiences of African-American alum and people who are affiliated with the university. And we've talked about doing that for the town, right? And one way that we might be able to do it in an organized way is through the university's design center, because they're about to start an oral history project for Alamance County. And so if we can somehow connect with them to say, can you do the oral histories for the ballpark community? Right. Or can you do the oral history for people who may not live in Elon anymore but grew up here? Right. And so I think it's important not only to hear about incidents that happen, but to get a big picture of people's experience. That may have something to do with why people don't vote. So you might want to, the more you know about the community and a person's experience in that community, then you can begin to figure out how to get people involved in the community. So I'm hoping we can connect with the Design Center's oral histories, which are starting up, and give them some direction as to who they should talk to. So.
That'd be great. And Mr. Wood, you had something?
I think it was one piece of data that came across from Mr. Rich, and she collected our data. I don't know, we're looking for some more. It seems like when we went from every 2 months of paying the water bill to every 1 month, we've got 109 people that are delinquent every month getting water turned off. So we're trying to look at the data now to see if they're getting water cut off every 2 months, or it's just because we went to every 1 month. So that's some data that we will probably be.
Yeah, I think that's a really good thing to look at because, you know, when we went from 2 months to 1 month, the thought was that someone was paying a lower bill, right? And that it would get better. So I think that that's really good for you all to look at to see, did we not look at that right?
Or even ask the question when we meet others.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you so much.
You need a motion to, do you need a motion?
The request is for, if it's a change to the code of ordinances, it requires a public hearing.
Yeah.
Yeah, you wouldn't be voting on a change tonight.
We would be
voting to send it through the ordinance change process and letting us know which version you want to move with. The proposal there, which one do you want to proceed with?
I mean, I think we had provided the feedback to include the firms, partnerships, and corporations. So I guess, do I have a motion to follow the amendment change process for proposed amendment number 2?
Yeah, I would make that motion.
Do I have a second?
I'll second.
All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? All right. Thank you all so much.
Thank you
all.
Thank you.
All right, moving on to ordinances and resolutions. We have a request to approve a resolution to close an abandoned Gregory Drive.
You need anything up on the screen?
I do not.
So, Mayor, members of the board, you already had the other item related to this on your agenda tonight. This is actually the formal resolution that is required by North Carolina General Statutes. And just so you're aware, and the petitioner is also aware, so the petition has already been approved. If the resolution's adopted, then what happens is we get it recorded in the Alamance County Register of Deeds along with Exhibit A and B. Once that's recorded, then the petitioner would actually record Exhibit C, which would divvy up the land that's within the right-of-way. And so then the property would go to the adjoining property, and then you could apply for your building permit, Mr. Bird.
Quick question with it. Do we have to pay for surveyors to go out there and?
No, so the applicant has already hired the surveyor, and that's what was submitted, the plats. So they're sealed by the surveyor. If this is adopted tonight, then the surveyor is going to get me. He already gave me a sealed copy, but he will give me a copy to sign off on because it's been approved as the LDO administrator. Like I said, it would then be recorded as soon as the resolution in Exhibit A and B is recorded. But yes, the survey work has already been done by the applicants.
Any other questions for Lori? Do I have a motion to approve the resolution?
Make a motion.
Do I have a second?
I'll second that.
All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion approved. All right. Next up, review and consider FY24 budget amendment number 7 for the West Trollinger Sidewalk Extension Project.
One of those ones, it's always difficult to know which order to do this in. Ask you to make a budget amendment for a future vote on approving the bid, and then you make the budget amendment. But either way,
gentlemen.
For several years now, we have talked about extending the sidewalk on Trollinger. It stops at Holt. We want to run it almost all the way down to Church Street. We had a budget estimate of about $280,000, and the idea was we budgeted for it over 2 years. So last fiscal year, we had, I think, $127,000 budgeted. This year, third year, we had $153,000 budgeted for it. Unfortunately, that $127,000 expired at the end of the fiscal year because we didn't have a contract yet to write the purchase order on to preserve the funds. We have since gone out to bid, and the bids came back in. And lo and behold, we actually came in under what we'd estimated. The weighted original budget, I think, was $280,000. The bid plus inspection costs and a contingency brings it to $195,000. The budget amendment that you're being asked to consider this evening. $42,000, I believe. That, along with the $153,000 that we have in the budget, will get us the $195,000. It will allow that project to proceed. An item further down the agenda, you'll be asked to award that bid based on the results that we received.
Rich, I have one question about the design. This sidewalk,
mm-hmm.
existing sidewalk,
is right next to the curb, isn't it?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Would that continue on down Church Street, or would we conform to what we trying to green space between the curb and the sidewalk?
There will be green space. We are trying to do this sensitively. So we're not coming back 5 feet off the edge of the pavement and plowing a straight sidewalk down and cutting everything in the way. We're trying to work around as much we can. There will be some trees that will have to come out, but we're trying to avoid that aspect of it because we don't want to change the whole character of the street. So there will be a variable setback from the edge of pavement to the sidewalk. Some places it'll be a little bit greater than others. There may be some areas where it's close to zero. I don't recall there was any spots that were actually zero anymore.
And there won't be fire hydrants in the middle of the sidewalk or poles in the middle of the sidewalk? Like,
again, since that's all existing, it's easy for us to avoid them.
And the other thing I concerns about, because I just hate it when I walk down College Avenue, the driveways where the sidewalk's here, and it dips down, mm-hmm. and it dips back up, dips down. Is that going to be a consistent level? Just like we see here on on Williamson, where the sidewalks are, it's a dip and back up. So how has that been engineered?
I don't know.
Yeah.
I didn't get down into that level of the detail of how thick the gravel is going to be. I will say that typically you do dip down at driveways, if for no other reason than to keep water where it is. You don't want it backing up into the sidewalks. So that's partially why you see that kind of a design. Particularly when you put sidewalks in. Well, if you do it later, then you're excavating, probably building up higher than where the driveways are. But even in new projects, you like to see a little bit of grade separation. Somewhat inconvenient. In some places, it works better than others. Sometimes it's other times it's more of a gradual thing that you can work on.
Yeah, my purpose for saying that is I want this to be a sidewalk that we can be proud of 30 years from now.
Yeah.
But that's as long as it's going to live. And
yeah. Well,
we're having to redo things now that
yeah.
Have shortcuts.
I will say this will be a less what you think of as a sidewalk and more what you would think of as a, kind of a meandering path.
Greenway.
Skinny greenway. Because we are, like I said, we are trying to avoid destroying the character of the street by taking down everything. And
any other questions?
And I said all that with memory of looking at the plans 3 months ago, because I don't have them here with me tonight, but there will be that variability.
I have a question.
Sorry, Mr. Woods.
I have a question not pertaining to this, but it's pertaining to sidewalks. So,
can we just hold until the end because there's no public comment or hearing on this item? Okay, thank you. Questions for Rich?
So you need approval to start the project?
This is the budget amendment request. So
yes,
looking for approval.
This would take some of the money that we put back in the fund balance on June 30th, reallocate it to this project in the current fiscal year.
Do I have a motion to approve budget amendment number 7?
I'll make that motion.
Do I have a second?
Second.
All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? All right. You've got yourself a budget amendment. Moving on to, now we get the bid award. So review and consider bid award for West Challenger sidewalk construction.
Doesn't stick around long, does it?
Right.
So in your packet, you've got a letter of recommendation from the town's engineer summarizing the bid process, what the results were, and they reviewed the bid documents to conform to our scope of work and found that it meets our criteria. And the recommendation from Ali Williams and staff is that we go ahead and grant that bid to ASJ Wilson Construction, amount of $169,618. the actual construction price. The rest of the budget, construction administration, is a $10,000 estimate. We need to have our inspectors out there making sure it's done the correct way. And then a project contingency is also included in the budget amendment. Already done.
Have we worked with them before? Have they done anything, any projects? I'm sorry.
Not that I'm aware of. We have not worked. Yeah, we have not worked with them, Pat. Did do some significant background on them and came back very positive. So I don't think that there was any concerns raised from the information we received.
I will say this is probably the top sidewalk that I hear from residents that they want, because they don't like to have to dodge the people walking on the street. Mm-hmm. This is probably the top one that I get comments about.
And this construction company is aware of the meanderings, any greenway?
I got the plans. Yeah. I mean, it was all designed ahead of time. That was part of the bid package that went out. And so they bid that design.
And you're within the time frame that they're not going to try to raise it or anything at this stage.
No. It's a month ago.
Okay.
So no, we're all set.
I like the motion.
All right. I have a motion to approve. Do I have a second?
Second.
All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? I'm curious. Next is review and consider disposal of town-owned property.
Okay. We've received a letter, which is in your packet, from Mr. Oakley, who owns land further out Manning, but also owns the first home on the easterly side of Manning as you head up from the university. He sent us a request asking if the town would be interested in selling him or conveying to him one side or another the property that we own right at the corner of Manning and University. It's the site of an old water supply well that has been discontinued and capped and closed. From the town's perspective, there is no frontage to it, or there's no access to it. We can't come on off of University, and the only access is via the driveway of Mr. Oakley's property that crosses over the town the boundary lines. You've got the map that's in your packet. You have the request. And the other thing that I wanted to include was I went to multiple department heads who have options or interest perhaps in the property. Public Works, fire, planning, police all said that they didn't have any need for it, didn't see a public use for it anymore. Wilson, our recreation department, noted that the town lacks any kind of park facility on the far side of University. Particularly with, you know, we have existing populations out there, the new subdivisions taking place out on Manning will obviously add town population on that side of the university, raise the possibility of whether some sort of a neighborhood park might be able to put under that piece of property. As I said, it's not a horrible location. There are some access issues that would have to be resolved if we were ever to pursue something like that.
How big is it?
I'll tell you. I got it. It is calculated acres 0.68.
And the property is behind that. Is that part of Park West?
Northwest, yeah.
That's what I thought.
Yeah. Park Northwest comes in and abuts the rear of our property.
And have you looked at that from any implications as far as how they're developing or what this landowner wants the land, that they could possibly have some argument or something with the Park Northwest?
I don't think there'd be any argument. I don't have the Park Northwest plans in my with me are extremely clearly in my head right now whether there's actually access. I don't think we had required them to provide access to Park Northwest to our parcel. So I don't think I think it butts, but I think there's woods there at that end of the subdivision. So gaining access to our piece from Park Northwest is not a real viable option. Okay. And I think it's, you know, if Mr. Oakley was to put a house or anything on the town piece, I think it's buffered well enough from Park Northwest that I don't think anybody have any complaints with it.
Can you put a house on 0.68 acres?
Mm-hmm. We have a proposal in front of you to put 4 on 1 acre, or 0.6 acres even. So,
that would mean that they would have there would be no access to anything.
They would, except the owner, the developer would own the adjacent property and could presumably make that work.
Yeah.
Well, currently the easement is on their driveway. So to get to this property, you have to use Mr. Oakley's driveway.
Correct. And the other thing is that I look on here, it looks like he's already developed a piece of it anyway for his use.
Well, there's certainly parking happening on the town property.
I think he mows it.
I think he does, which is fine, but I just want to make sure that we've covered all of our bases before we make this decision.
So the question is, he wants to buy it, but wouldn't we have to put it out for a bid?
We have options. We could put a for sale sign on it. We could hire a real estate agent. We could put it out to bid. That's part of what the discussion tonight. I mean, typically we've put them out the bid in my other communities that I've worked for. We'll advertise that it's available and sell to the highest bidder.
I mean, I just feel it's, he approached us. Yeah. I mean, if we have the ability to do the appraisal and directly negotiate with him, and when you already have to use his driveway, I just feel like that's a more respectful way to handle it.
Then there's Park West. What if they had an interest in that property?
Well, why? It's not included on their plan that we've already approved.
They could add it, make it a park.
So I understand what you're saying there, Monty. But I think
I'm not opposed to it. I'm just saying, to be fair, someone's approached us about acquiring a capital item we have. Mm-hmm. And I think we owe it to our citizens to make sure we get a fair return. It may be $1,000, maybe less.
Sure.
But I think we have to put that opportunity out there. You're right, there's really only two parties that have an interest.
Well, and I'm going to have to side with him, right? I mean, I think we talk about it, and we see people like this resident who's getting ready to have a giant development in their backyard. And you know, one way to prevent that is buy the land and not have it happen. And we get a lot of people. I'm always going to side with this guy.
I agree. I mean, I would be wanting to do the same thing.
But I understand, you know, trying to be fair, but I mean.
But we would get a fair market value, right? Absolutely. By doing the appraisal.
You can say yes or no to
what. Or no, because technically we could be like, hey.
We whatever we get for the property would be discounted by whatever we had to pay for the appraisal. Now, the appraisal is only going to be a couple $1,000. I don't know, putting this out to bid, Park Northwest may be interested.
Do we have to get an appraisal?
To sell it,
yeah. I mean, if we were to sell it to an individual outright, we should have an appraisal. Because, as Monty said, our part of our job is to get fair return for the town. So
$31,000 tax value, yes. Which we know that's overly inflated for that property because there's landlocked.
Maybe.
I mean, does have... I'm assuming there's an easement over that driveway that we've had that would go with the property. So, you know, could have access. But if we were to just negotiate a price, we would need to have an appraisal. If we just put it out to bid, presumably the market is going to tell us what the value is by what we get for bids. Now, limited number of people would have an interest, which would affect... You know, it's not a true market value problem, but likewise, putting a real estate sign on it is not necessarily going to give us a true market value because you know, not many people can be interested in it.
Well, wouldn't putting it out to bid kind of solve what Monty's talking about? I mean, as far as it's allowing anybody that's interested in it, and they're probably not going to be anybody interested other than him. Right. So it would kind of,
but does that care of your concern?
I mean,
I don't know if that's true, though. I could see Greenhawk being like, there's potential there, and then we can go to this guy and buy that. And I just.
He could buy it for $5,000, turn around and sell it $50,000. So that was my point, is that
That would be the biggest
concern. Yeah, we could sell his parcel and that parcel for whatever reason. We just helped him out.
Yeah, we can certainly do an appraisal on it and then put it out to bid with a minimum price based on the appraisal.
Yeah.
You know, I understand being fiscally responsible for our citizens and making sure that we get the best price possible, not easy to say, for the land. But there's also something to be said about being good neighbors and being a good, constituent of the land. And I think that this gentleman and his property have withstood or going to as this develops. And I just, maybe it's not as fiscally sound, but from my gut, it doesn't feel right. He came to us and I feel like, this should be something that we obviously would get the price that the land is worth. And if he's willing to pay it, then give it to him. But to send it out to everybody and go, oh, we didn't think of that. Now we're going to jump on it. Just doesn't feel right to me.
I mean, that's the way I feel. Yeah, I'd rather go option three from the list, which is the appraisal and directly negotiate, or just not at all. I mean, from my standpoint, but I think that, would he be interested in leasing it?
I mean, I wouldn't want to do that either.
Lori, you've had conversations.
Sidebar, I've met with Mr. Oakley, and I'm the one who encouraged him to talk with Rich. He purchased Ms. Henshaw's property in April of this year. And you can see the neighboring property is a weird shape. And so he asked, would the town have any interest in selling that parcel? Because he wanted to combine them and redevelop the site. So that's just a kind of sidebar. I don't know what has in mind.
We make money on both being good neighbors.
But we could also make money. But
well, then I'll just sit on it.
It's an unused piece of land. Yeah.
What does he? You say what he wanted to redevelop it into?
He mentioned a possible business, but we did not go into any further in depth because at that time he was had just purchased the Henshaw property.
What's that zoned?
An R with a T&D overlay. So it would have to be rezoned. So you would potentially see that project if there was a rezoning case.
Well, if that's the case, let's just sit on it. He wants to redevelop it.
Well, based on what we've just heard, though, a bid or at least opening it up might be the better way. But I still think we need to do an appraisal.
If you have a conversation with an attorney the other day, if there is a redevelopment or development intention, we can investigate a public-private partnership. But if he needs our land, there's a possibility we could negotiate directly with respect to the development that he wants to do.
The lawyer,
I said a lawyer was actually an architect.
Oh, okay.
Because he said, yeah, you could do that. And I said, well, I would want to verify that before I,
None of us are against improving that property around there in that neighborhood. I mean, I think that's the ultimate goal. If it's redevelopment and it enhances the rest of the town, then I think we should be open to that. But my point is, just don't give away a piece of property because you think you're doing a neighborly thing. Ultimately, it may help the town by redevelopment, but we just don't know that.
No, I don't think giving it away. I think fair market value.
Lori, do you know what if we give them that
prop parcel, what the total combined parcel?
Theirs is 2.23.
So take
about 3 acres.
Yeah.
2.8, yeah.
Okay. And it would make it into like a perfect triangle. And I will say, because it's been over 6 months since we had
a conversation. You're going to have to back Manning.
Do what?
You're going to have to back out on Manning.
DOT would probably require the driveway to come off of Manning. Absolutely, any development. But I do remember now looking at the comp plan that that area is called to be commercial in our future land use map, that whole intersection there on that quadrant. Again, it's been a while since I've talked with him.
That makes sense.
Specifics. Mm-hmm.
Oh, people are going to lose their minds with that commercial.
Just that one quadrant right there, but yes, commercial.
That could be super beneficial.
We need to look at that.
Yeah.
That's another thing we need to look at in the LMO. That's
no, but that could be.
Well, it's not zoned. The LMO, I believe the draft zoning map still has it as NR, but just know that the map in the future land use map in the comp plan says it should be targeted as commercial.
But you said it has a TND overlay on it.
Yes, it does.
Which
requires a mix of uses, including commercial, which might be a little harder to go on 3 acres. Mm-hmm.
I don't think 3 acres would be enough.
Do a lot of 3 acres.
I'd make a motion just to, I don't know if it's a motion. I recommend, I'm talking to my colleagues, that we just kind of sit on it, maybe just get it appraised. But like, we don't have to rush to anything right now. I don't even know if we need to rush to appraisal. But knowing that, I'm down to just hang on to it and see. What's moving?
I mean, I think I'd be more inclined to listen if I knew what this proposed development might entail.
Yeah, right. We have those conversations.
Right. I think we're all for developing smart.
Well, and we as a town just don't own a lot of property. So, I mean, if there's a potential opportunity for a private-public partnership or what have you, I would hate to just sell it or even just put it up for bid right now and we don't have that option in the future. So I don't think we do anything about it right now.
Would it be a table or just an action?
Well, go back to him. I mean, I have no idea.
I guess what the cleanest thing would be to make a motion to offer the property for sale and vote against it. That way it's off the agenda. We're not tabling it till some future, which makes it clear.
Are you on this or do we need to table it?
I don't know if we need to do that though. I mean, I would hate to say no and then.
But you can take it up later.
Reconsider.
Well, I need a reconsideration. It's all right. New information comes in. I mean, I've heard what you've had to say.
Right.
And, you know, the phone call is going to be, we need to sit down and talk.
Is it an action?
Why do we have to take an action? Yeah. Why can't the action be for you to bring us more information?
Yeah, I'm fine with that as well.
I mean, if somebody called me on the phone and said, you want to sell your house, I don't have to answer them.
Mm-hmm. No,
it's like he wants us to sell property. We don't have to answer him. You can talk to him further, but I don't think we have to give an answer today.
So if you want to table it, then we'll just proceed.
But for me, I mean, if there was an answer today, the answer would be no. I want to have more options.
Okay.
So
I don't want to close the door. I just think
right, I don't
want to. Yeah. I mean, in other conversations that are similar to this, we typically have an option, you know, like other option defined by the council. I would say we're choosing other option defined by the council.
I'm fine with that. You would ask me what I thought. I thought to get it off the agenda
is just to go ahead and try to sell it and say no.
I'm fine if you want to table it. Just go ahead and table it, and I'll follow up with the owner or the neighbor.
I think the direction that we're giving you is to get some more information.
Yep.
Does that include an appraisal, or would we need to vote on whether to have an appraisal at this point? Because I think that would be valid information to move forward. I mean, we're sitting on, if, you know, Monty brought up, this is a really
property offers, so we don't know what he's thinking.
Thinking, right.
So why do we have to have appraisal?
Right, because it could be a potential appraisals for whatever tax value is, $31,000. But if his idea is to do X, Y, and Z, then that gets in that appraisal through the roof. Yeah. So I'd hate to just have the appraisal. I don't think we have to appraise it right now.
Not right now, no.
Just thinking more information.
That's fine.
And then once you have that, we can explore another.
But does that require a tabling?
No, we don't have to take any action.
Vote. Is that correct?
Okay. We've done it lots of times before.
Okay.
Instruct staff.
Review and consider approving AIA contract between town and Allie Williams, Harmon, and King.
Yes.
AWCK.
Left to chaos.
Yeah. Mr. King's going to be upset.
Yes.
I don't think he's alive anymore.
As you recall, we received a $300,000 grant from the state a year or so ago for this asset inventory and assessment, which is to look at our water lines primarily. Lead and copper are the issues. Allie Williams helped us write the application and the scope of work until we got the grant. As I recall, we went out for proposals. Allie Williams was the only respondent. And so we'd like to enter this into contract with them to actually go now do this asset inventory and assessment project under that grant. You've got the the cost is governed by the grant, so.
So the hourly charge rate, that would only come into play if we went over, or how does that come into play? Or is that factored into the total cost?
What paragraph are you looking at?
This is Exhibit 2, page 5.
Page 73 and 75 in our pack. All part of the same thing.
Can you just show in the comparable rates?
Yes. Okay. This is how they bill.
Got it. It's
their billing rates. We have a scope of work that they've said they'll achieve. And if we decide to add to it, this is what those costs would look like. I don't anticipate that happening.
I think it's a really important project after we've seen so many issues with drinking water across the country.
Yep. And
in Burlington even.
And we have, you know, water lines that are of an age where, lead was likely in some of the solder. We do monitor for lead on an annual basis in different parts of town. And occasionally we'll get small hits that so far have been, we've come to the conclusion that it's on the services and based on the home's ages and the way we do the testing, we go back and run water and, do it that way. But it's not to say that we don't have that issue in some of our water lines. We just haven't found it yet. This will help us do some of that research, map it all out. So we have a good understanding of where we know the water system. This would document it completely for us, types of pipes, size of pipes, age of pipes, and things like that, and give us good information about where we might have issues of contamination or potential contamination.
This is doing due diligence for our residents.
Absolutely.
Ready? Any questions? Do I have a motion to approve the award awarding of the asset inventory and assessment contract in the amount of $300,000 to Allie Williams, Carmen, and King for the attached scope of work.
I'll make that motion.
Do I have a second?
I'll second that, Mayor.
All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carries. Moving on to reports, we'll start with the town manager.
Emailed you the September month reports earlier this afternoon. I apologize for not getting them out sooner. And the last week was unusually busy after I got back. So just as a general announcement, since I've been here, and I don't know if it took place before I got here, but we've hosted a wellness fair for town staff, introducing them to folks from our insurance companies, other vendors in the area, on wellness topics, services that are out there for them. We skipped it 1 year during COVID. It is this Thursday, October 12th, and it runs from 11 to 2 or 11 to 3, I'm not sure. But what we'd like to do is close town hall between 12 and 1, so that, because that's when the food truck will be there for lunch, and so that people have that ability to use their lunch hour while the food truck is still around. The temporary expansion of our downtown district obviously is now in place, and this Thursday is going to be opening night of the new Toasty Kettles Beer Garden on North Holt. It's immediately adjacent to the University Tap House building. Power is, I believe, is all secured. Lighting's in place, and so we'll start that trial process over the next this Thursday and take it into December and see how it goes. Saturday is an unusually busy day for Elon. 8 to 10 a.m. is Cars and Coffee at the Community Church. Coffee by Oak House. Also at 8 o'clock, running through noon, is the Household Hazardous Waste Collection out at Holly Hill Mall. And at 10 o'clock to noon is the Autumn Bash, which in the past has been called the Awareness Fair, I believe. That will be taking place down at Beth Schmidt Park. Town departments will be there. Some surrounding departments of public safety will be there. I know in the past, Duke has been there. DOT has been there. They're going to have kits for your kids' DNA if you want to do that. topics,
the father.
And fire safety demonstrations and that kind of thing. So that is taking place Saturday morning. Next Wednesday, October 18th at 6 p.m. is the joint meeting between the planning board and the council, 6 o'clock here. And that's to receive the presentation and hopefully provide your comments on the draft LMO. And I would encourage you to bring your comments to that meeting rather than the public hearing, just so we can get those things moved along and get them in place. Would not have to compete with whoever from the public shows up. And lastly, and this is a kind of a heads up, October 27th, 4 p.m. is the Halloween happenings out at Beshmet Park. And I believe the theme this year is Hocus Pocus. Yeah, treats for trunks.
Friday.
Friday
evening.
It's because we're starting early and until 6 or 7, as I recall.
Surprisingly, a lot of people show up.
Oh, yeah, they're going to be there.
Yeah.
Oh, it's a lot of people.
What time was the hazardous waste at Holly Hill Mall? 8 to.
That's all I've got.
Great. Randy?
It's appropriate for us to just be mindful of what's happening around our world right now and with what's going on in Israel and the Gaza Strip. And just want to be prayerful and wanted to raise that. I don't have a whole lot other than the impression that we our
our sustainability committee is slowly growing, and we just got some positive word today that we have a new representative from the university that's going to be able to be a part. Really excited about that. The only other thing that I have is that Farmers Market will be done on November 9th, so it's coming up rather quickly. So, but it's been a very successful year, and I think that Jill and Sarah just deserve a lot of credit for this year has really changed the Farmers Market. It's really developed a much bigger thing than we've had, I think, than I've ever seen. So I'm just really pleased about that. So other than that, I don't think I have anything.
Monty?
Yeah, to reiterate what Randy said, I think about the Jewish community and those who have loved ones in Israel. You know, an act of terrorism took place just like we experienced in 2001. And just continue to keep those folks in your prayers and realize we're never safe. We always have to be vigilant, protect our country and our rights. So hope you do that. This past weekend, I had the opportunity to attend First Baptist Church of Elon celebrating the 75th anniversary. It was kind of interesting. I grew up in that church years ago, but where they started and where they went and where they are now, it's a testament to longevity. And I applaud them for continuing to be an important part of our community.
When you said you attended, you weren't there when it was started, though, just to be clear.
I just think it was there on Sunday.
That's great.
Is that it? Stephanie?
Oh, I definitely want to thank the Diversity, Equity, and Belonging Committee for coming tonight and all the hard work that they've been doing. They've really sunk their teeth into making sure that they're going, and they're really serious about making changes. And I really appreciate all the hard work. And I appreciate Randy and Monty's bringing up Israel. Obviously, it hits hard. For those of us that are Jewish and have family and friends there, and just your thoughts and your prayers do mean a lot. So thank you very much for that.
So today I went to the Alamance Chamber's Economic Development Committee that I sit on, and it's a rather small group that's happening today. But it seems like there's a lot of things moving around in the county. Mebane's growing. Burlington's growing, but our chamber is really active in doing things. And I think the chamber is working with the town to help try to fill out the Med Deli position, or the spot to hopefully find a business to come there. So it's nice to partner with our chamber to try to figure that out. We do have the beer garden, Toast Kayla, starting this Friday, or this Thursday. So look forward to seeing what that's about. I need to send a message to Jill. We're supposed to have an arts advisory meeting the third Wednesday of every month. But this is going to be our planning board at 6. So I don't know if we need to. Yeah, we meet here. And it's at 5.
Is it 5?
No, it's from 5 to 6. So that might be something to look at. But talking about the Arts Advisory Committee, you know the electrical box right there near Cynthia Huffon's? We're looking at getting an artist to paint over that, so it's just not this big black box. And she's meeting with Artie Burksdale, I think that's his name. He's the guy who's done the murals around Burlington and Hall River and Gibsonville. So Jill's meeting with him. I'm not sure about what, but just meeting with him. So a lot of things are happening. I look forward to the spooky season, and I echo what Randy said with Jill and Sarah with the Farmers Market. It's super awesome. And I hope we can, you know, maybe we can all plan on meeting on the last one down there. It would be pretty neat just to cookie. That's a great cookie.
It will be done early. It will be done early on the 9th too. Just remember that. Because the dark will get, yeah, it'll get dark. So.
I eat cookies in the dark, bro.
Mark?
Yeah, I want to echo what Stephanie said as far as the DEF committee. Y'all done a great job, very thorough job in investigating different things. I'm very impressed with that. So Thank you, and echo that to your fellow committee members there. And also, obviously, the situation in Israel is horrific. And, you know, again, we pray for all the folks over there. That's all.
Thank you. Just a couple of things. I will not be here for our next meeting on October 23rd. I have to travel for work. I think I already gave you that, Rich, but you'll get at least one.
Out of a last hurrah.
Yes. One thing that I have witnessed, and I know that you all have already heard about this, are people walking in the middle of Williamson to go around the construction at the plaza. I think that maybe just in the future, if we're going to do something like that, having some sort of safe route, because we know that people are not going to cross and come back around. I actually almost saw a toddler get hit by a car in that area. Again, the family chose to not go across and come back over. They were in the middle of Williamson. Like so much so that me and other people audibly gasped, like we thought we were going to see an accident. So just whatever we can think about, if there's another project where we're having to do that, we've got to figure out, we have to think about human behavior, and they don't. Clearly don't think about the fact that they're walking on a state highway.
Yes. I will say at our last meeting with our engineers, actually came about because I sent them an email saying, we have some capital projects coming up. We need to fix your work so that pedestrians are being addressed better. And they came in and they have complete traffic control plans for both of these projects, Trollinger as well as the water line, so that there will always be pedestrian access segregated from vehicles.
Okay, thank you. I did miss the church event. Unfortunately, I had to attend a celebration of life on Sunday. So I was out of town for that, but I had planned to go to the church event. I met with the student government president at Elon University, as well as representatives from the university related to the LMO last week. Rich and I did an event for Elon Votes where students had a list of questions and things of that nature. So it was good. I thought it was really fun to just be asked questions about how our roles differ and what we do. And so it's always fun to do those types of events. And soon we will be appointing a skate park committee, hopefully. So TBD, we have a lot of interest in the committee. There just haven't been a ton of actual Elon residents on that committee, but we've gotten a few. So, hopefully that those appointments will occur. In our town council manual and procedures, that is an appointed, committee. It's an ad hoc committee, so I would just appoint that. Just wondering if you all want to review that before I make those appointments, or I mean, my plan was just to take the staff recommendation since it's a temporary committee. But any
concerns? So I think the three of you, she was going to put on it, so. So you know.
Yes, and if you're on it, you have to skate. So, that is all. Do I have a motion to adjourn?
Motion.
A second.
Second.
All in favor, say aye. Uh-huh. And Mr. Woods, we are available for your questions.
Okay. CRX.